Hello everybody, welcome back to playing another episode of Total War Warhammer. I'm the Strategy Professor. We're doing a Middenheim Legendary Campaign. Now, unfortunately, the first episode glitched out. I ran out of disk space, it didn't close. I thought that I had enough space, but for some reason it took up way more than I thought. Anyways, you didn't miss that much in the very first episode, but we had a good turn. So I'm just going to go ahead and keep going with it. I know it's a little unusual, but all that we did was we just fought a beastman herd right here. It was a pretty standard fight. It was okay. We decisively won it. Obviously, I'm a little annoyed because I lost that first episode because I checked the disk space before I did it. But we're going to move on. And I'm just going to recap. Basically, all that I did in the first episode was I fought the beastman and I just talked about the overall strategy that I was going to use and what's different about Middenheim from the normal Empire campaign. And so I'm just going to go over that stuff again here really quick. So it's basically just going to be like episode one all over again. Just instead of fighting the Beastmen, we'll come down here and fight probably the Secessionists and maybe Empire or Marienburg pretty soon. So what's up with Middenheim? So I'm using the Locarian mod, Modular Factions, which allow you to pick some factions, some minor factions that you can't normally in the game. So you can do Border Princes, you can do Middenheim. I am doing other campaigns with Crocodrock and the Moussion Vampires, so be sure to check those out on the channel. All of them legendary. And I don't exploit the AI in any way, so I don't auto-resolve abuse, I don't assassinate lords on the campaign map, and I deliberately try to take on very challenging circumstances. So I'm not the kind of person that sits back and just chills in the town and just plays it safe and just does kind of a by the numbers legendary campaign. We go out there, we look for fights, I try to make it exciting, and more importantly, I try to make it a campaign that helps you become a better player. So it's all good if I beat the campaign and we have some cool battles and things like that, but the real reward for me is knowing that people learn how to play the game and enjoy it better, and maybe beat the game with their own legendary campaign. So that's what we're aiming for here. So this episode, I'm just going to talk about my overall strategy, what I think is good with Empire, some stuff maybe to avoid, and just a playstyle that I think can help you benefit in your own gameplay. Okay, so Middenheim, their passive is plus 10% melee infantry units and plus 15% speed for infantry units. So plus 10% weapon strength and plus 15% speed. Boris Todbringer is the main person. Got his army down here. I'm working my way towards the Secessionists. He starts off with a Empire Knights and two Greatswords as sort of his premier units, and then he gets sort of a standard Empire starting roster. He has a couple of cool traits. He gets Rune Fang, which adds a lot of extra damage to his attack, and then he gets Crush the Weak, which is an aura where if someone goes under 15% leadership, so if they get scared, then they lose 13 melee attack, 4 leadership, and 12 melee attack. There's no cinematic also, so you didn't miss any opening cinematic with this because it's a mod for a minor faction. Obviously, the mod person didn't develop a full cinematic for it, so you didn't miss much there. Now, he has pretty high melee attack and defense, which is good. He has magical attacks, which cuts through physical resistance. That's bad against dwarves, but good against other people. He has a silver shield, so he blocks 55% of missile fire, which is very good, and he has pretty competitive armor, which is nice. Now, on the first turn, I did pick up a brass cleaver, actually, so I think I'm going to equip that instead of the rune fang. This is one of the best weapons in the whole game. You want one person in your army to have this, if it's the lord or a hero, just somebody who's going to be in the melee scrum, because 8 melee attack is a really big deal for everybody in an area, so that's awesome. As far as skills, now I learned a lot in my original Empire campaign. Be sure to check that out if you haven't yet on the channel. In that the initial skills are the best, usually, by far. So this stuff is nice, like the 12% for great swords and Empire Knights and all that stuff, that's all good. But it's a percentage, and percentage is not as good as a flat number. So remember this number, 12% extra weapon strength, 12% more damage. But if we look at something like Honest Steel, 12 melee attack, If something has 36 melee attack, which I know the normal swordsmen don't have that, let's just pretend they do, then they would get a 1/3 bonus. That means they're dealing 33% more damage because they're hitting 33% more of the time in melee combat. Now, they start with 32 melee attacks, they get even more. So it's probably something closer to like 38% extra damage. And they get plus 12 melee defense. That means they're, and their melee defense is 32 also, I believe. So that means that they're going to be taking, you know, 38% less damage in melee combat. So, you know, we're talking about a 76, roughly 75, 76% more combat effectiveness versus this, which is 12% more combat effectiveness. So you can see really quickly why these early ones are much more important, because they have flat numbers, which are more powerful for flat bases. Now, if this was something like, you know, plus 12 melee attack on something that had 300 melee attack, there's not anything like that in the game. But if it did, then that wouldn't be nearly as powerful, because the base number is much higher. But when you're dealing with low bases and you're increasing low bases, the percentage increase is much higher. So we're going to be going on a steal. Notably, that also affects free companies. This is important. It gets spearmen, swordsmen, and free company. Free company, I think, are the most powerful pound-for-pound unit in the Empire roster, and perhaps in the game, just because they have such high melee attack and melee defense, and they shoot, deal respectful damage, and they move quickly, and they have sort of okay armor. I mean, they just do everything. They're like your Swiss Army knife. So you don't want to run, like, an entire, like, roster of them, but they are quite powerful. Because they also benefit from Pistol Corps, which I'm also going to get this, because it's 12% damage and 12% more ammo, which in a long fight basically means 24% more damage. So that's really, really powerful. This is okay. This is okay. Like I said, this stuff up here, if I'm going to get something, it's going to be this late game. That's good. I mean, 15% ward save for Demigriffs and tanks is good, but that's a really, really late game tech. That's like, you know, turn 100. You might get that. So we won't get that. I don't like getting duelist stuff. It's okay, but I would much rather benefit my whole army. And he doesn't have any super cool mounts. He does have a barded horse, which is good. So we'll think about getting that. It does lower his melee defense a little bit, gives him a greater charge bonus, gives him more speed. So we'll almost certainly get that. That'll make him more powerful. Now, this tree down here is absolutely amazing. This stuff's okay. It's sort of whatever. You get recruitment cost reduction and probably fervent. But this right here is amazing. This is one of the best trees in the whole game. Now, they did rebalance this as well. They moved Lightning Strike over to this slot. It used to be right here. And it's the most powerful skill in the game with every faction. The single point, one point wonder. Now, what Lightning Strike allows you to do is attack a unit, and if there's reinforcing armies, you cut off the reinforcements so they don't get to reinforce. So you just force a 1v1 fight, which is really, really important when you're facing multiple stacks of very dangerous units to take them out one at a time. So you really, really want Lightning Strike with every faction pretty quickly. So it used to be here, but they switched Headhunter with Lightning Strike, which is a very good balancing switch. Lucarion did that. So that's good. Headhunter is very good too. Plus two unit for unit recruits and capacity. That's amazing. You want these chevron experience upgrades. Each chevron gives you something along the lines of 2 melee attack and 1 melee defense, and it gives you extra missile damage. There's just a lot of really, really good things that you get when your units are upgraded. So you want to try to get those upgraded as soon as you can. So this is a really good 1-point wonder. 15% upkeep reduction, absolutely crucial, amazing, lets you field more units, more armies. We're going to need a ton of armies to cover the large geography we're going to have to cover up here. So really, really powerful to get Quartermaster. And Logician. Casualty replenishment, super important. Empire doesn't have a lot of good ways to do that outside of Battle Priest. So you definitely want Logician just to keep your armies topped off, so you don't have to sit in towns and heal for very long. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to do, we got Root Marcher first. You need the 10% movement range. And then we're working our way over towards Honest Steel. We just got 2 levels, like I said, from beating the Beastmen. It was like a 13 on 13. It was okay. But, you know, it's not game-breaking, game-shattering that you didn't get to see that fight. There will be much more like that. So, we had such a good turn. We got the Brass Cleaver off of that fight. So I just wanted to keep rolling with the campaign. So hopefully that's okay with you. Like I said, you didn't miss that much cool stuff. And then elsewise, what we did, we just upgraded this. Speaking of buildings, we want to get to the tier 3. Relatively quickly, so we can get an Empire Captain. Those are very strong, powerful units. You can't get the Great Swords, unfortunately, until you get to tier 4. but the tier 3 is important for getting the Empire Captain. And we need to get a forge as well. So once we get this forge, that will allow us, if we get Karaberg up to tier 3 as well, or which one is it? Wiesmund. Which one has the chapter house? This one. Okay, we want to get this. Now, you can't get the Outriders. We're not going to get the Outriders with grenade launchers for a long time. And we probably won't get normal Outriders either because it requires a gunsmith. So we're going to do the blacksmith. And that will allow us to get these knights. Now, the Empire Knights are very powerful. They're great. And this gives them, it gives you plus 4 public order, which is really important. And it also gives you plus 4 experience for the knights, which is absolutely crucial. So that's what we're going to be working towards. Speaking of which, let's go ahead and upgrade. And upgrading all the smaller towns, it slows down upgrading your big town. But it does give you more public order, and it does give you a little bit more cash, and it gives you more growth. So, you know, you kind of, it's okay to upgrade laterally as the Empire. It's some really good choices there. And you want to be able to get the money buildings and or the public order buildings relatively quickly too. Okay, so building wise, that's what we're working towards, just great swords and Empire Knights. And, like, Denigriffs are okay. They're super expensive. They take 3 turns to build in the normal campaign. I just couldn't field a lot of them. But Empire Knights, very, very strong. You definitely want those. So the core of our army is just going to be great swords, you know, some denomination of normal swordsmen, spearmen, and free company militia, and Empire Knights, and maybe some pistoliers. Alright, so let's go ahead, and I do want to replenish a little bit more. Walk down here. This will give us some more public order. A turn of replenishment. And what do they have? The technologies, we'll just get them as they become available. Basically, we want rally field stuff and blacksmith stuff. Once again, that's really good for the kinds of units that we're going to be getting. The harbor is good. We need to get a harbor first. We won't be able to get this stuff. We're not going to be able to get the building for it. And then barracks is good too. I think that's a tier 3. Yeah, so all of the stuff that we're getting also gives us the best techs, coincidentally. At least for the first, 50 turns of the game, and then we'll get some other stuff. Okay, so what are we facing? Normal stuff. We can't get, crossbowmen yet. It's gonna take a few turns. We can hire these guys. We'll wait till next turn to grab them. Maybe a couple more free company. Take us up to 17. I don't want too many of them, but I do like having free company. Let's do that. I don't think they're going to have horses this early in the game, so we'll get one more swordsman. Spearmen aren't really that effective in normal melee combat. They're okay, but you really want to go with the swordsman. If it's just going to be someone who's just putting their head down and staying in combat. Okay, I think that's good. Also, diplomatically, what we did last turn is, what I decided to do is I'm going to see if I can play nice with people in this region and just go south and try to take on Marienburg and the Empire if I can. And maybe Bretonnia. And just work my way through here. And we're going to try to... We're angling for a confederation with Nordland. And we'll see if we can confederate with the other factions as well. If you move up this way... then you're going to be right on the front door of Chaos. So that's problematic. I'm hoping that this guy will help insulate me from scaling in Varg a little bit. As they start filtering down. In my normal Empire campaign, they came down and just like... non-stop, just beeline straight for me. So we're going to try to avoid that if we can.
Greetings, my countrymen.
Now, Hawkwind's acting kind of weird, but I think we've got Nordwind on board. and maybe Talabikland, we'll see.
I will listen, but my time is short.
And it's important to read some of these. He's reliable. now, Nordwind is an underdog, so that's really important to keep in mind, is that they actively want confederations most of the time. Let me see if they'll hook us up. Sometimes if someone's green, they'll give you some cash. Not always, but sometimes they'll just throw you some cash every, you know, 5 or 10 turns. This is a sign of their friendship, but you have to ask for it. Okay. What else? I think I covered everything. So we did buildings, we did techs, we did skills. I think that's good. Okay, let's go ahead and go. So once again, sorry, you didn't miss a lot in the first episode, but we got that brass cleaver, man, and that's such a good start. I just wanted to keep it. Man and woman. Now we have lots of female viewers as well. I just say that as kind of like a generic term. Okay, so we've got our powerhouse army here. We need to make use of it. Servant of the faith. He's got some pretty nice stuff. He's got some handgunners. The Empire Knights are really the big deal. We need to get that Panther House. Or that Chapter House soon. Ready. Order of the Panther. Okay, so this is 10... Do they have 15 units? Can I hit them this turn? I can. Okay, let's see if someone will pay us to go to war with them. They're at war with Empire. Okay, so let's see if Empire will pay us. I mean, I would love to confederate with the Empire, but they really don't like us that much, I don't think. Yeah, they're not gonna like us.
The Celestial College implores that I hear you. I remain unconvinced.
All right, let's see if they'll pay us some money, though. A little bit. Okay. So, we have 300 gold. Or a free 300 gold. They want to trade? No. They want anything new? It's always important to just take a look at diplomacy every turn. I know it can seem a little, especially when you're Empire, it can seem a little tedious, but... I will marshal the men. No, this might be auto-resolve. This is going to be a murder. Do they have a 20 stack? They do. 27 units. In a siege. I don't really have great siege. I mean, these things are good, but... It's going to be hard to hold these territories, too. But... Now, if I get enough upgrades for Honest Steel, then we might be able to siege them. I could hire a secondary lord here and just really go all in on this. What does the Emperor bid? And just attack them with like 30 units in a siege and maybe beat them. I really need crossbowmen before I do that though. I think I'll just chill on that. Once I upgrade this and get crossbowmen, then we can think about a siege. You want a lot of crossbowmen in a siege. Then you can just rain arrows down on them, obviously. Now, they don't have shields, right? They do have armor, but not shields. It's been a while since I played Empire. Yes. Okay. Alright, I don't want to hire the guy, because this is just going to be overkill, and I need to save money. It is time. Fight for our nation. Oh, wow, they're giving them much better odds than I thought. Really? Y'all think you're gonna beat me, huh? Okay. I guess I could have hired the guy. We'll see. We'll see if my greed ends up costing me here. But I really need to try to conserve some money. See, we get a good fight. There's gonna be a good fight every episode. We will run into the Beastmen again. They didn't have anything that cool or impressive. It was just a bunch of Ungor little crap units. They didn't have like Minotaurs or Cygors or anything super cool. I don't think they had anything that was large, but we'll keep these separate anyways. I really love the Empire. I talked about this in the first episode that will never be seen. but they're just so versatile. They by far have the most diverse unit roster of viable units. Now, there are factions that have diverse rosters, but sometimes the units are just garbage. Like, with the undead, Vargeists are generally pretty bad, as are Hex Wraiths. There's a lot of stuff that just gets outshined. But with Empire, there's, like, almost every unit is actually viable in different circumstances. And doesn't get strictly upgraded. Yeah, like, the swordsmen do get out-upgraded, but they're still very cost-efficient and useful, even later into the game. They're probably the best-designed faction, I think, in terms of balance. They don't feel overpowered. Like, they're not the best at anything, but they are very competent at everything. Like, they have decent artillery, decent cavalry, decent melee, decent magic. They're just awesome. If you love strategy, which I assume if you're watching this channel, you probably do, they are a fantastic faction. Okay, so how many... I have one set of crossbowmen. Crossbows ready, General. Our steed direct them. Crossbowmen! Formation, march! For Helden Hammer! Yes, sir, quickly! Great sword! So if you just lock the formation, then double-click, they just run forward and charge into the nearest thing, which is usually what I do with my, We're going to use the free company over here and try to flank around with them. They have pistoliers? They don't have pistoliers. Okay. Quick march. Crossbows ready, General. Freak them out a little bit. They do get a little wigged out if you go for the full surround. Just like a normal army would. You know, sometimes people are like, oh, the AI is stupid. I'm like, no, they aren't. They have done a lot to improve the AI. I mean, yeah, they're not going to be as good as like the world's best player probably, but they're pretty competent with their tactics. I mean, they can't do anything about this. I'm just going to pinch them in. They don't have cavalry. Fresh. We just want to make sure we stay fresh. I'll go ahead and speed this up. Sometimes if you try to move them all at once, it sort of wigs them out. Ah, stupid camera. Realistic camera. Now I outrange these gunners, or this free company militia. Alright, let's go. Go, 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 go. Ooh, I don't have shields with these guys. That's not good.
Markles!
We serve the Emperor! By Galmaraz!
Finisher!
Free company!
All ranks!
Understood! Shoot them!
Sigma, cool! Sigma!
Stop! We obey! Weapons draw!
Free company! For the Warhammer! We are Sigma's heirs! The Empire endures! And the field is so windy!
The Helden Hammer!
General!
Finisher!
Take the ground! For the Warhammer! Fire! Free company!
For Heldenhammer!
Sigmar guides us!
We obey!
Free company!
Yes, sir! Sigmar calls! At speed!
By Galmaraz! No lingering! Weapons drawn!
Sir! Ready for the twin-tailed turret! Attack!
Ready for war! Free company! We serve the Emperor!
Attack! It will be done!
Crossbowmen! Hammers ready! On our quick march!
Finisher! Ready! Raise your weapons!
Finisher!
Yes, General?
For the Emperor! We serve the Emperor! Taking position! We are Sigmar's heirs!
Yeah, free company militia are sweet. I like them. So they're not very accurate, and they're very short range, but just being able to run around and shoot people in the back is pretty nice. It causes a lot of public order problems too. Or not public order, leadership problems.
Crossbows ready, General! Take the ground!
Lodge!
Understood! Free company!
Understood!
Sir! Let's try to get as many hostages as we can here. Remember, if you start scaring them by shooting them in the back or charging them in the back, then they lose, or you get all those extra bonuses from Boris. It's pretty fun to watch him. Alright, we got the Lord. That was their legendary Lord. Okay. It would be an interesting campaign to start with, like, Empire Secessionists. Dang, yeah, they killed a lot. Look at that, 125. They're lighting people up, shooting them in the back like that. And he's killed 163. Yeah. And you see the infantry? I mean, some of the infantry did kill quite a bit. But, like, these free company, like, if you get around and just start shooting people in the back, like, it's a lot of damage. Yeah, so they killed quite a bit. Crossbowmen killed a lot. Most of the swordsmen are just kind of like, whatever, you know, they're okay. The knights usually kill quite a lot. They didn't kill as much this time. They were chasing, chasing missile infantry around, so. There's not that much here if I sack it. I could sack. I'm just going to occupy, though.
It is for the best.
Oh, wow. That's really nice. Oh, cool. I did get to keep a growth building, so that's good. Now, it is going to be hard to hold this territory without taking out the Empire. And it's going to be really hard to take Altdorf until we get just like a critical mass of great swords, probably, just to run up the gate. I mean, a lot of mortars could maybe do a good chunk of damage. Cannons are really nice because they take out towers. Like, there's a few different strategies to sieges, so if you want to win sieges. So number one is you can stack everybody on one side and use cannons or something similar to knock out the shooting tower, and then you could walk up and just hose everybody down with artillery and crossbowmen. That's a viable strategy. Another one is you can just run up, beat down the front gate, and just like run in and just have units that are very good in close quarter combat. This is what I have to do with the undead a lot, especially if you have regeneration magic. You can just power your way through the front gate. Or a third one is you can kind of power your way through the front gate, but then also use flying units to disrupt all the stuff on top of the walls.
The nation calls.
All right, honest steel, biggest power spike in the game is when you get 3 points honest steel. Makes you so much more powerful than everyone else. Can we take out Marienburg? I don't think so, not yet. So we need to at least knock out the rest of the secessionist stuff so that we can gain some levels. Okay, did I look at... Let me see if I looked at... They probably like us for killing secessionists, right? Yeah, they like some of our stuff. I mean, it's possible that we could confederate with them.
I hold Galmaraz. You may bow. Ready.
I don't know. Marienburg is a lot easier to hold. Like, this is where I want.
It is time.
I'm just not gonna have the money for multiple stacks. Oh wow. Those have missile penetration. And much higher base. I really want those. How much missile pen? A good chunk. And they have higher range. Those are real strong. Now I do want to put him on a horse. It's important that he doesn't have magic damage when we try to fight dwarfs, because they have magic resistance. So magic damage is good against things like hex wraiths, or just wraiths in general, but it's not so good against other things. Okay, I don't want to hire a lord now. I mean, I could hire a lord and just like really go hard and try to get to 10 units. I mean, there's definitely an argument for that. How much is hiring a lord? Okay, Spurned is not good. Boring. I mean, all of these kind of suck, honestly. Ugly's okay, but I don't want... Ugly's actually pretty good, but I don't want an Archlector. I don't think they have Honest Steel. I think they have specific, just other stuff. Very flagellant specific units.
I will marshal the men.
I can't beat them 20 on 20. Or not 20. It's not even 20 on 20. They get their garrison, which is now tier 3. But that port is so good. You get 1,000 gold off that port. So as with most factions, money is a huge deal.
The nation calls.
There's no way I'm beating Carl in a... especially with this stuff. I mean, the growth is nice, but I think I just want to sell it. 300 and just put a money building there. So I'm not going to get that capital for a while. This is what I want. Okay, so how? Okay, so let me see. If I hire a lord, that's bad. That's okay, I guess. That's really bad. That'd probably be the thing that I would get there. Oh, that's a dude anyways. That's an Archelector. $825, $250 per turn. This army costs 2430, so even a smaller army would probably run me like 1,000 a turn. I'm not getting anything that's giving me cash right now. I'll wait a couple of turns on it. I need to come down here, gain some levels, get Honest Steel going, get some more money, put money buildings here. Before I can deal with them, I think.
The Empire.
Yeah, we'll wait. We just need more cash right now. Yeah, our town is just like giving us nothing, basically. There's no other trade agreements, right? I can do. Did I already check Hawkwind this turn?
Surely an agreement will be reached.
No. Okay. Let's go to the next turn then. Blackstone Post. Okay, Isleheart, I need money. Even though this is probably going to fall, this is important to note, even though this is most likely going to fall to rebellions or Carl's going to come take it, if you build this, it's 250, so it pays for itself in 3 turns plus 2 turns, because it takes 2 turns to build it. So in 5 turns, it pays for itself, and you get 250 per turn. And if you sell it, then you get 400 back. So really, it's about 2 turns. So really, if you can hold it for more than 3 turns, and you're getting value out of it. So even though you might sell it later, you can't be afraid of that. Like, you have to invest in the money buildings. They're so crucial. Speaking of which, it's probably what we're going to get here. Like, yeah, it would be cool to get this. Or the tap room. I mean, the only other thing option would be tap room, which is definitely a consideration. Growth. I think we're going to have to go public order now. I mean, the growth is good, but we're going to have to go public. I want all of these upgraded. We do want to get to tier 3 on this, but that's really expensive compared to this. And we need the public order, the growth, the money building, primarily. And we're just going to have to go money. So that's going to take us to 64, and then we're going to be losing like 7 per turn. Think. Or, I mean, maybe we do go tap room. I can go up there and kill one rebellion here in a little bit. My secondary army can kill him. So at this, we're going to get to 4 public order. That's going to take it down to 7. So we're going to go 64... and then, so that's 36 at 7 apiece. That's 5 turns until a rebellion. I think we can handle that. I'm going to go Weaving House first, and then maybe with this one, I might go public order. We'll see. And we need to upgrade this, because I want more crossbowmen. Who knows? I mean, we might get a flagellant. just one, just to try them out. I mean, maybe they do more damage. So maybe if I get them, like, use them to flank from behind, and they're just not taking any hits at all, and they're just hitting people in the back. They do have a nice charge bonus. 26. Whereas these have 16. Yeah, so maybe I can just use them as sort of a flanking type of unit. Just like a poor man's Empire Knights. Maybe we'll get a couple of them just for funsies. We'll see. But yeah, we probably want to go ahead and upgrade that. That'll let us start getting techs too, and it's really important to get those techs rolling. How are we looking on time here? I forgot to set the alarm this time. Did it last time. 41 minutes. Okay, I'd like to keep it to about 45 to an hour. Ready. Right, go knock out Helmgart. Seems pretty easy. Free money. Raise your weapons. Ulrich's will. Now we're just going to auto it. This is going to hurt the public order a little bit. One problem without having a provincial capital is you don't know where the rebellion's going to show up. So there will be a rebellion, but we have no idea where. I will actually sack this one, because I need that money. Okay, excellent. Oh, nice. Oh, it's so glorious. We're getting really good followers. Now, we could just take it. I mean, the barded warhorse is really good, but... Now, keep in mind, that opens you up also if you wear your horse. You can take the mount off. Like, you don't have to have the same mount every turn. But if you have the horse, that opens you up to spears as well, so it's not great in sieges. So you definitely want to take your horse off for sieges. We're still just going to go honest steel, though. Go ahead and take it. This will bolster the nation. So we're gonna have some public order problems here soon. Oh wow, it still gave me this? $300 to demolish it, huh? I mean, I could hire more units here if I want to. I mean, heck, can I just... I mean, I am overextending a little bit if I do this, but I could just go on a rampage and come down here and take out Montfort. I really wanted to, or at least sack it. Or Carrick Agaraz. Yeah, let's go ahead and sell it, and then we'll get a money building. Yeah, I feel like that's overextending a lot to come down here and start taking this, but if I start hiring another army up here, then I could maybe hold that. It's kind of a weird pattern of just like beelining straight through all this stuff. For the wisdom of the land.
I will listen, but my time is short.
They're at war with Marienburg.
I will hear what you have to say.
I mean, we could try to play nice and confederate with Carl, but...
What does the Emperor bid?
I don't know. So we can hire these two. That'll put us at 20. Take out Montfort. How strong are they right now? And who are they friends with? They're not friends with anyone. They're kind of on the weak side. Who calls? Bretonnia is fairly weak early on. I mean, the thing is, I don't have great missile units. Like, I can take out their mounted yeoman. I can't, because they have more range than my Free Company Militia. So until I get crossbowmen, I really can't take out their, a lot of their units. Dwarves are really difficult to deal with early on. I could take out Karak Agaraz. Could grab this last Grunsberg area. Alright, this money's gonna come online soon. Do I need to start recruiting just yet? I'm not sure. I think I can wait like maybe one more turn, because you don't want to recruit this army until you're actually going to strike very soon. It's going to cost a lot. They're still hiring more, so they have 25 units, plus the 7 in the garrison, the 8 in the garrison, 33 units, so I need at least 30. They don't have mortars or anything. It's going to be tough. It's going to be tough. Treasure is pretty good. Castilian Engineer is good for the building. Now what kind of magic can I get? Okay, I can get them all. So I do want to get some magic. Fairly short order. But it's going to take a while. Their magic users are very far up the chain, but they have some very powerful magic. Okay, I think that's gonna be it. Can't get any techs. We'll see what happens this turn. I mean, we could just go sack Montefort, like go to war with them, sack them.
Approach and make your offer, but I make no promises to my ascent.
Underdog. So he does like to, he does like to confederate. I mean, I just can't fight Carl this early. Nah, I want to take Marienburg. I'm committed to taking out Marienburg. Okay, they are splitting up their army though now, which is good. So maybe I can fight them. Like, if I can knock out their army, obviously, if they aren't hiding in these walls, then that would be a good thing.
Valiant Lord. Now.
How is our public order not much worse? Because my army is just laying the smack down here, or what? Yeah, military presence. Need that weaving house. Do I just kill him and or just sack him? I can't take out Castle Baston. Foreign trespasser, where is this? Where? What? Oh, he walked through my territory. Six. Okay. Oh yeah, because this building finished. I think we can afford to get another money building here. And then with this last one, we might have to get the public order building. But we need money, 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 money. We're starting to come online with the money buildings. We're going to get 250. Like, we're probably going to be back up to about 1,000 a turn, which should be enough to finance another army. It's going to require me walking through Carl's territory, right? Or not? Whose territory is this? Empire Secessionist. Okay. So Carl's is right here. Karak Agaraz doesn't have a lot. I mean, taking out Empire obviously makes the most logistical sense right now, but unless Carl might actually be down there right now trying to kill them. Or I could rotate back up here, but I need to fight some things. I need more honest steel. That fifth They're that third point on a steal. It's a huge deal. It's 5 melee attack and 5 defense. Big deal. Okay, well, let's go down to right here, and then we can maybe spot what's going on over here. Because Carl went somewhere. I just don't know where he went. We could maybe take out Karak Agaraz. They might be headed over there to do that right now, but I'll take it out. We'll hold it, and then the rebels will probably burn it eventually.
So?
We'll see what happens. Okay, and I think... is that worth upgrading? I don't think so. Just extra 10 growth and 2 casualty replenishment? I don't think so. The growth is nice, but it's better options. All right, and I think we'll wait one more turn and then we'll hire a lord. Do we have any good looking lords here? Or are they all still terrible? Uncompromising is pretty good, actually. I think we'll wait. I think we can wait one more turn.
The Celestial College implores that I hear you. I remain unconvinced.
I mean, if I had a 40 stack with a lot of archers, maybe I could take out Carl. It's just... it's going to be real rough. They don't have a lot of archers. They have one... I mean, the horses aren't going to matter. The mortars are going to suck. To try to fight. Crossbowmen are good. I mean, if I can catch it where Carl's not there, though... and I attack it with like 40 units, then maybe I can take it out. Okay, so we won't do anything with Carl yet. One more turn on the rally field. That's done. I think. I don't know if I looked at Hawkwind yet or not. No. Nordland.
Welcome, my countrymen.
Military access. Yeah. Let's try to get that soon. We want to get those relations going as fast as we can.
Greetings on behalf of the Empire.
Beastenland. Oh, we're going negative. Oh, they're an aversion. Yeah, they really don't like us. Okay. Fair enough.
Why talk to you?
I mean, they might give us money. Should declare you I don't know if Carl's going for them. I don't see him right now. If he was going for them and he was going to kill him next turn, I could see if they'll pay me money for a peace treaty. But I don't think they're going to do that right now. Let me see if my homies here will sling me a little cash.
It is good to see fellow sons of the Empire this day.
Oh, not that. Just straight money. Just give me the money. Okay, sweet, so they hooked it up. Okay, so if you're friends with someone, like I said, if you're friends with someone for a while, then sometimes you can just ask them for money and they'll be like, sure. And we could go for dwarves. Dwarves are really tough early on in the campaign, though. Like, the greatswords are amazing against them, but free company militia, I mean, Empire Knights are very good against them, too. Well, why do these have a bonus? Melee attack and defense. Oh, just because they have chevrons, that's right. Okay. Okay. Next turn. Oh. Now he's probably going for Marienburg. Ah, damn it. This is what I was talking about. You don't want defensive alliances. Crap. Because now I'm going to be a treaty breaker. I think non-aggression means that you won't attack them. Well, I mean, Nordwin is the key, the crown jewel right now, so we have to defend Nordwin. Alright, we've got our text now. Speed is good, leadership's good, but I just want those chevrons. They're so important. Okay, so that crushed me, right? No, I'm still steadfast. Okay. So I did break the non-aggression. They broke the non-aggression by attacking my ally, though. Okay, so I still have a steadfast rating. I thought that was going to crush me. Alright, so now we get to go up here, and this is something we can do now. So we can actually fight Hawkland. Remember, even if we can keep these up for 3 turns, these weavers, it's more than worth it. Even if we have to sell it and the rebellions take out all the stuff, which is what's going to happen down here, you're still gaining money by doing that. How rich is that? That looks pretty rich. I could get someone to pay me, attack, sack, and then just run and try to get back up here, or I could just run normally. I'm not going to go for Grunsberg at this point. I need to get back up there. But I do want this money. It's just sitting here. It looks so juicy. It does have, like I said, it has some decent buildings in it. I think we'd get at least 1,000 gold for that sack, if not more. Okay, who's at war with them? They're pretty weak right now. They don't like us. They're at war with Carrick Norn. Let's see if Carrick Norn will holler at us here.
Manlings come. They only do when they want something.
Okay, high. So they really hate him. So that means they'll pay us. So they'll pay us for it, probably at least 500 gold. Then we can sack it. We'll get another 1,000. So that's about a 1,500 gold for a nice little detour. And that will also bring me up to steel, or 3 points in honest steel, I hope. Might even get us 1,000, let's see. Well, ask for more than you want. It doesn't hurt to ask for a lot. They have 5,000 gold, so... we'll see. It's a lot of money early on in the game. But we'll see what they do here. Because it's high, so that means that they really want it. They'll do 1,200. Okay, good. So we get 1,200 gold. We're going to war with someone that I wanted to go to war with anyways to start this fight. What does the Emperor bid? Now watch them be like in ambush stance right here and just kill me with like a 20 stack. I hope not. It is war. Fight for our nation. We're just going to auto it. It's going to be a slaughter. Got him. Alright, so now we're really strong. We have Brass Cleaver and 3 points in Honest Steel after this. Oh, sweet. It's even more than I thought. 2,000. I thought it'd be at least 1,000. So we made almost 3,000 or 4,000 off of that little exchange there. So that's pretty good. They're not going to come up here and fight me anytime soon, I don't think. They're going to get wiped out. They almost always get wiped out every campaign by these little people. Alright, let's go for Honest Steel. Big time. And now we might get the horse next, and then we'll start maybe with Pistol Corps. I'm not sure. We might go ahead and start this stuff. Probably do Pistol Corps next. We'll see. Almost certainly get the horse next, and then we'll do Pistol Corps. It is time. Alright, now we're running north. We're gonna deal with Hawkland, probably. Grab their stuff, and then we can come over and deal with Marienburg after that, I hope. We'll see. Once again, these places are gonna fall. I know rebels are gonna take them. I'm just holding out as long as I possibly can. I can't manage this territory without the capital, and there's no way I'm getting Altdorf right now.
Warrior of Sigma.
So... it's a lot of missile resistance. That's pretty good.
Yes, my lord.
Okay. Do I need to hire a lord? Maybe. I mean, Hawkland could come right for me. This has high walls, though. Is it worth the upgrade? 125. So it would pay for itself in 10, 13, like 14 turns. Am I going to need to get rid of it, though, is another important question. Because, yeah, a turn, just 1 point in money building is nice, but once I get to tier 3, I'm going to need this for sure. This. So that's two buildings. I mean, I would like to have a gunsmith. I would also like to have a wizard's conclave. And this is really good, too. I want a battle priest. What else? That doesn't give anything. Oh, it does reduce vampiric corruption. Or chaos corruption. Battle priests are quite powerful, primarily because of their replenishment. I mean, they do have some battle auras that are good too, but I want them primarily for the replenishment that they offer. You can only have one though. Is it really worth using a building slot for one? I mean, having the mortars is very nice for a lot of matchups. I'm not interested in this for a long time. Okay, so at tier 3, I only can have 3 building slots. 1, 2. The last one doesn't need to be money or doesn't need to be mortars. That would give me handgunners, which I want some of those. Not a lot, but like a couple would be good. They're kind of like militiamen. I mean, their thing is they have a lot of, they have pretty good range. They have heavy armor piercing, so they're really good against things like dwarves. If you can get around and shoot them in the back. Got the Panther Chapter House over here. None of the rest of this looks appetizing. That's good. So we'll get the public order stuff, plus the money building in all of these places, plus... Carpenter and the Panther House. That means I'm gonna need this. Cannons are excellent at sieging. They're very accurate and they knock out those towers. So I am interested in getting these cannons. How much is this? 4,000. 5,000. This is 13,000 gold for all these buildings. How many turns? I said I would need to hold on for 13 turns. And I'm not really in a hurry to... I mean, mortars are okay. It's really hard to take out town towers with mortars, though. Okay, I'll upgrade it. I might end up selling it later. And I can sell it back for, you know, 700 gold. So we'll have invested, what, 2250? Okay, I'll just buy it. It will pay for itself. I think it's going to be at least 10 turns, if not more, before I'm interested in getting the gunsmith. There's just so many other stuff that are on my priority tables. I mean, I do want the cannons, but they're pretty far down the list of stuff that I want. So, and I mean, I might even want the Wizard's Conclave before I get this. In fact, that's probable. Plus one Battle Wizard, that's... just still plus one. Okay, yeah, so we'll upgrade that. Once again, I will delete it later, most likely, but I just want to make some money in the meantime. You can't always focus just on end game, you know, exactly, like, you have to get there, you have to take it one step at a time. And think we can hold off one more turn before hiring. I want to hold off as long as I can just so I can generate this money. I don't think they're going to attack me. I think they're going for Marienburg. It might cost me. Now, I am in between Hochland and Nordland, though. I'll tell you what, let me go ahead and hire. Let me go ahead and hire, just because I'm scared that they're going to come through here and mess with me. So I'll hire in Wiesmund. This will help with the public order, too. I feel like I'm being too greedy at this point, not hiring. This guy's pretty good. Actually, before I upgrade that,
to the provinces,
we can put this guy. Oh, it's local region. Dang it. I should have hired up top, and then it would cost me less money. There's 10% reduction in building cost for this, but it's not province, it's region. Okay, so that means I'm going to be waiting a turn then before I upgrade the money building, probably. Well, it's 125 a turn, and I would save 10%, 150. Okay, so it's worth it to wait. So we'll wait, and then we'll start it next turn. You save the upfront cost.
The Empire, we march!
So I don't think it's going to affect that, right? It's still... Yeah, it doesn't affect it. So I'll have to run up into that territory next turn.
Now,
go ahead and hire. Like, I do want one of these to flank. They're pretty bad in sieges. These are the cheapest upkeep, so we're gonna need those. So let's just go ahead and get those. You want to get the expensive upkeep stuff last.
Ready.
Start hiring. Let's combine a couple of these.
Praise Sigma. What does the Emperor bid?
Since we're not going to replenish that much on the way, and that would save a little bit of money, we can just rehire them once we get up here. If they're off your books for three turns, then it's worth it if you rehire them later. In terms of upkeep. Usually. Like, what is the upkeep? It's 105 upkeep, and it costs how much to recruit? Okay, so it's four turns. So if they're off your books for four turns, they're a little bit more expensive than other factions to hire. But anyways, whatever. That's fine. Okay, and I think this might be it for this turn. I'll go to the end of the turn. Yeah, we're an hour and eight, so we're a little bit over on the first episode. That's okay. Alright, so let's do...
The Empire!
Oh, good. I think I looked at the... Got that going. I think I looked at the diplomacy. We're going to wait on that, remember, until next turn, so we save the 150. So we're netting, like, 25 gold if we do that. I mean... But 25 gold is 25 gold. Okay, let's do it. Yeah, he's just going over to Marienburg. Now, if he weakens them, that would be sweet. Okay, so they're about to fight.
So what can the Empire do that the mighty flower of Bretonnia cannot?
On aggression. So they see me kind of massing up on their border. Let's see if they'll pay us for that. I'm willing to do it, but they need to pay me. No, I don't care if you fight them. Just whatever. That's fine. Okay, so they wanted to run through my territory. That's why they wanted the non-aggression. So they wanted to show me that they weren't...
You. The Grand Theogenists should declare you traitors and heretics.
Now, if I do peace with them for 10 turns, then I can attack them again later if I need to. It's free 600 gold. Yeah, I'll take it, sure. Oh, no! I thought they changed that. Someone told me they changed that in a past video because I declared peace with people. Crap, that's really bad. So what happened is I made peace with someone that I declared war on within 10 turns of declaring war, and so now I'm untrustworthy. Which sucks, because I really need diplomacy right now. God bless. They told me in the elf campaign I didn't get untrustworthy when I made peace with somebody. And someone's like, oh yeah, they changed that, you know, a few patches ago. Well, clearly they didn't, because I just got untrustworthy for going to peace, accepting a peace treaty with someone that I went to war with 10 turns ago. So that sucks. So we will get the reliability back, or that's really going to slow down our progress with Confederation with Nordland, and maybe these other people too. And people will be much more likely to go to war with me now and break treaties because of that. So that sucks. That sucks real bad. I mean, we can work around it, but these goblins are harassing me now.
Protector of the realm. I will marshal the men. Who calls?
Damn it, that's gonna slow me down to get up here to Hawkland.
Not possible.
Raise Sigma. So they have kind of a weak army up there.
To the provinces. Yes, a sound plan. Moving off. Yes. Honor before glory.
Okay, well, that's going to be it for this episode. Thank you very much. Hope you enjoyed it. Sorry, once again, that you missed the first episode, but like I said, you really didn't miss that much. I just covered everything that I talked about in the first episode, for the most part, which is just what my grand strategy is going to be, what I'm going to do. We'll figure this out next turn. But yeah, it looks like it's going to be really fun. It looks very similar to the old Empire campaign. We start in a slightly more dangerous spot. We get to run with Boris this time. We get a few more limitations on our roster, but it's really not that much. You know, like we can't get Witch Hunters and we can't get as many Battle Priests. So it's definitely harder than the normal Empire campaign. But it's a lot of fun. The Empire is one of my favorite factions, so I hope you'll enjoy this as well. But thank you very much. Stay tuned. Episode, and I'll see you next time. Have a wonderful evening.